What's up, Data Nerds? We are back after a 2-1 week to recap last week, the divisional round best bet hit, which was awesome. So we hit that at Saturday, actually, with the Bills minus 2.5. So good luck to everybody who took that, or good cash to add to your pocket there. So let's try and keep that going to this upcoming week, the championship week. And as we go on in the playoffs, one of the things that makes gambling and handicapping a little bit better, if you've been paying attention, that is the entire year, is the amount of teams that you have to handicap obviously dwindles every week. This week, again, we have four teams, only two games, and that's awesome. That's why I love it. We can really dive into the deep analytics, get into the tiny, minute details that are really going to help the handicapping. Biggest issue, and I've said this before, is that every week in the playoffs, these teams are going to pull something out that they have never done before, something that you don't have a lot of tape on. Obviously, they're trying to win, which is great. But for us, that means there's at least a couple of variables we just don't have a handle on. We won't have a handle on, neither will the opponents. But that's why my coaching grades come into play so much during the playoffs. And so far, I have a 70% accuracy rate with my coaching grades as far as straight-up winners go. So if you were going just off of my report card, just money line or straight-up winners, I've won 70% of the time in the playoffs, which is great. And now we're looking, of course, to make sure we can continue that with spread picks. One thing I would like to note is that both of these games, as of right now, and this is Tuesday afternoon that I'm recording this, have a 3-point spread. Like I've said before, only 8% of the games in the NFL are decided by 2 points or less, so 1 or 2 points. And that's not just from this year. That's going back to the 1970s. It's an average of 8%. So if you can get a 3-point spread, if you win, you should cover the spread. So basically, you're going to cover or you're going to outright lose for the most part. As far as report cards go, the Packers, strictly speaking about the playoffs, and obviously they've only played one game this year as far as the playoffs are concerned, but they have the highest grade so far. They have a grade of about 51.43 compared to the Buccaneers, which have 45.17. Now, the Bucs actually have the second highest grade as far as my analytics are concerned, but they're still about 6 points behind, which is about a 3-point difference. So as far as the spread is concerned, that's pretty clear as to where they're getting those numbers from or why they have a 3 posted up there. I will tell you, it's being juiced up right now. In a couple of books that I've seen, it's a minus 3, but it's minus 3 with like minus 125 for the VIG. So definitely, you know, shop around, get your best numbers. As far as the grade and what's going into it, and you know why I personally think the Packers are the best play on the board, I mean, are my best bet, is really going to come down to EDSR, which is, again, early down success rate, and then one-score win percentage. So how many times did these teams play in a one-score game, meaning that the final score was decided by 7 points or less? The Packers played 9 games this year that were decided by one score or less, and they won 56% of the time. The Buccaneers played 8 games that were decided by one score or less. They only won 38% of the time. And the reason that's important is, if we think that 3 is the right number, and we think that it's going to come down to one possession kind of game, or it's going to be a closer game in this matter, we need to know that the coach knows how to handle everything that is goes along with that, meaning the time clock, when to call timeouts, whether he should or shouldn't challenge a play, is he going to take the field goal early, is he going to keep going for the points, what is he going to do? Who's better at managing these one-score situations? Not to say that Bruce Arians is terrible, but as far as this year is concerned, LaFleur has been better with the Packers, and that's a big reason why they score so much higher as far as my grading process is concerned. To get kind of further into this, I do have a weekly matchup score or scorecard that I produce every week for the games that I'm going to be interested in or betting on. This particular week, obviously, they're both games, so there's only two. A couple of the things that stand out to me, the Packers, adjusted for the Bucs defense, should have about a 53.5 EDSR when it comes to the passing game, which is about 2 points higher than the Buccaneers. And I get it. If you look back earlier this year, the Buccaneers absolutely demolished the Packers. I believe it was week 6 of the regular season. What you won't see there, though, is that at least it won't jump out at you if you're just looking at a stat card, is that Aaron Rodgers threw a pick 6 early in that game. I want to say it was the first quarter, maybe the second quarter at the latest. But he threw a pick 6, and they went down, I believe it was 7-3. And from there, it honestly seemed like the Packers just stopped trying. If you go back and watch that game, or just watch the highlights even, you'll see the Packers, they get the ball first, they're moving, you know, they're doing their thing, no issues there. Then after the pick 6, it's like they couldn't do anything right or something happened. And I promise you, by the time third quarter came around, the Packers all but threw in the towel. It just looked like they really didn't want to be there anymore, didn't care. Coaching wasn't even looking that great. So you're going to hear a lot about that first game that they had this year. And I really wouldn't take it to heart because I don't know how much the Packers are really interested in that game. Once they went into halftime, again, it just seemed like they came out very flat. So I don't think we're going to see that here. Again, we are going to have this game in Green Bay. So, you know, take what you want. It's going to be cold. It's going to most likely be snowing. The wind really shouldn't be too big of a deal. Brady's used to playing in the cold. He's used to playing outdoors. Obviously, so is Aaron Rodgers. So I wouldn't bet on the weather having such a huge influence in this particular game. And that kind of goes into the passing EDSR as well, because obviously if it's going to be really, really windy, like we saw in the Bills game last week, that can affect just the accuracy and how well the passing game is going to work. We shouldn't see that this week. The only player I would say may be affected, that I'm kind of curious to see how they react in this cold weather, is Chris Godwin. Mike Evans is going to just about get shadowed by Jair Alexander, and I don't like that matchup for Evans. I don't think he's going to do a lot in this game. He gets shut down by really good corners because he's a big physical guy, which is great, but corners like big physical guys. They like to get their hands on you. They have you real close in coverage and make you make those tight contested catches. Jair Alexander is going to do that, and he's going to, I wouldn't be surprised if Mike Evans ends up with a 2-30 kind of stat line. Antonio Brown may or may not play, depending on his injury. If he plays, great. I mean, he's used to the cold as well. I wouldn't be surprised if he sits this one out, but again, we can't really determine that just yet. So either way, though, it's going to come down to Chris Godwin as far as receiving core is concerned, and again, going into this pass EDSR, if the Buccaneers want to try and kind of win this passing battle, they're going to need Chris Godwin to come up big. The Buccaneers have a track record of using him, and I'm sure if you've played fantasy, you love Chris Godwin. He's working out of the slot. Brady goes targeting him. He's kind of a chain mover and a touchdown scorer almost every week at this point. But the Packers know that. The Packers know that that's the one guy that they're going to have to really focus on once they stick Alexander on Mike Evans. So it's something interesting to watch there is how Chris Godwin reacts to the cold. Is he going to have a tell? Is he going to be a little bit slower, a little bit less crisp because of the weather conditions? You can see it in previous years going way back, considering Green Bay, to the Ice Bowl with the Cowboys and the Packers. If you go back and watch that, Bob Hayes back in the day was, they called him Bullet Bob Hayes for a reason, and he just could not operate in those cold conditions. It's not going to be that cold this time, but something to just kind of keep an eye out for. Moving along to the run EDSR, really about equal here. Once we adjust for both of the defenses, they have a 52 EDSR for the Buccaneers, 51.5 for the Packers. The only thing I would like to say about that is it's going to depend on Ronald Jones and his health as far as his quad. Leonard Fournette he's fine. He's a guy, but he's just a guy. Ronald Jones is the guy who can keep them kind of afloat here and win that rushing battle between the Packers and the Buccaneers. But Ronald Jones has got to be healthy. He's got to be able to open up, and that's been his problem. Is he could run fine, he could jog, but when he tried to open up for that sprint, you might have seen it last weekend. As soon as he tried to sprint, it's like he stopped. The muscle didn't want to work for him. So, assuming he's okay to go and he's clear, I could see the Bucs winning the rushing game. But even winning that, it doesn't matter if you can't put up enough points on the board. You got to be ahead or be at least in a neutral game script in order to keep running as much as they would like to. Coaching grade, like I said, that's, again, Packers just have the advantage there as far as coaching is concerned. The heavy blitz, now this is one that has not been talked about a lot. So the Buccaneers do love to blitz. They actually blitz about 40% of the time on dropbacks, that is. Now, that has been effective to an extent. And I think one of the biggest reasons, and again, it's not really being talked about, but one of the biggest reasons the Saints had so much trouble was because Taysom Hill was not available for their game. The first week of the playoffs, you saw Washington really struggle with Heinicke. They kept blitzing him, and he kept running out of the pocket and getting free and making huge gains. Drew Brees wasn't going to do that to them. I thought Taysom Hill was going to really be an X factor in that game had he played, but because he wasn't there, the blitz was consistently getting home, or at least hurrying Brees and not giving him a lot of time to find his receivers downfield. And so I know the talk is that Brees doesn't like to throw deep. He doesn't like to go down the field. He likes to take the quick little out routes. And that may be true to an extent, but you have to have time to let those deep plays develop. And if you're constantly getting someone in your face, you don't have the time to let those deep routes just develop. In this matchup, though, Rodgers, while he's not as great as he used to be as far as scrambling or just extending the play, he has won 75% of the time this year when he plays against a defense that blitzes over 30%, which is what I would call a heavy blitzing team. So anytime he plays these, or I'm sorry, 75% of the time when he plays a team that's going to blitz him this much, he's going to win. And that's because Aaron Rodgers is he's just a wily vet. He knows who he's looking for. He's going to read your defense. He knows where your blitz is coming from. He knows who and who's not going to be open, and kind of where his read is at, and he's great at making those reads. While I don't think he's been as great, I know he has not been as great statistically at extending the play this year, I think in a playoff game he might try and, revert to his old Rodgers ways, even if it's just for 1 week, to kind of run out of the pocket, take what the defense has given him, and pull his best Heinicke impression out. So I wouldn't be surprised if that becomes a factor, just Aaron Rodgers' mobility and being able to escape that blitz. And I think that's one of the key factors here for me, is that Rodgers is capable of doing that, and it gives a huge leg up to the Packers against this Buccaneers defense. Going along again with the coaching grade, so two things here that are really pointing in favor of the Packers. Next, we have the personnel set. So both teams love to run their 12 personnel as their second base set. Their first base set, of course, is 11 personnel, which is three receivers, one tight end, one running back, if you weren't aware. As far as the 12 personnel set, though, neither of these teams are really weak against the 12 personnel. They both allow about a 50% success rate, which is about average, so not a huge deal there. Like I previously said, though, one thing that is different about the playoffs is that these coaches are going to make adjustments. They're going to cater to their opponents. They're kind of cater their game plan to the opponents and make sure that they're taking advantage of the weakness. So it's important to know where these teams are weak at. The Bucs are actually weak against a 13 personnel, which is one running back, three tight ends. They give a 55% success rate to that particular personnel set. The Packers don't run that a lot. I believe it's about 3% of the time that they run that set. And I think a lot of it's just they don't have tight ends that they trust. I wouldn't be surprised, though, if they try to kind of formulate something similar to a 13, or they do run the 13, basically just a heavy personnel set. Once they get in a heavy personnel set, they can do a couple things. They can use that to pass out of and really protect Rodgers, give him as much time as he needs. They can use a play action out of that. They can do quite a number of things out of there to really frustrate the Buccaneers and keep them kind of on their toes. As far as the Packers are concerned, they are weak against the 22 personnel set, which is two tight ends, two running backs. And I'm sure you've heard this because everyone's talking about it. The Packers are terrible against the run. That is true, but being terrible against a 22 personnel set kind of leads you to that, because that means you don't have the personnel to contend with a big lineup. You just don't have the guys who are literally strong enough to move against five linemen and two tight ends, and then probably a fullback to come in and block as well. So they need to be on their toes for that. They need to see that 22 personnel set or any heavy set that comes in and kind of adjust to it, making sure that they're going to stop this run early. They can't let them get going, because if they get going and Ronald Jones or Fournette just keeps picking up chunk yardage, it's going to be a long day for the Packers. I think that's really the way the Buccaneers win this game, would be to get their ground game going. Obviously, I love passing and I prefer that a team pass first. But in this particular situation, the Buccaneers have the advantage when it comes to running, and you might want to at least try that the first quarter or two, see if you can kind of get that going, or see how much the Packers are going to give you, and then adjust to what their defense is doing. But either way, it's just something the Packers need to be aware of. The Buccaneers do run a 22 personnel set about 8% of the time, so it is a little bit more common to see them come out in that heavy personnel set. And kind of has the same advantages. It will give Brady a little bit more time in the pocket. They can run a play action out of it, because a lot of teams are going to immediately think run when they see that setup come out. As far as turnover ratio, and this is strictly for the playoffs, the Buccaneers in some ways have an advantage because they've played two games versus the Packers, who've only played the one. The Buccaneers have been able to come up with a 40% turnover plus turnover differential. Packers have not had that luck. They haven't had any, actually. Next is directional tendencies. Buccaneers love to pass short left and right for a total of about 54% of the time, which comes out to about a 105-106 QBR. And one thing that I did note, just looking back through their plays here, Tom Brady, I should say, loves to pass deep down the field 10% of the time and on first downs. So, and deep right, specifically on first downs, really something that a lot of teams don't prepare for, because a lot of teams are still under the old mentality of we're going to play up close and not give up the run and play for the first down kind of deal. So if you're passing deep down the right side of the field, a lot of times you're going to find a one-on-one matchup, or you're going to find something that you want to take advantage of there. The Packers, on the other hand, as far as their defense is concerned, when it comes to short left and right, they do allow about 105 QBR short left, which is where Tom Brady loves to work. So I could see Tom Brady using those little short routes there, like I said, to a Chris Godwin, and just keep the chains moving, just keep the time moving as well, and kind of grind it out, mix that in with some running. They only allow the Packers, The Packers only allow 79 QBR short right, and that's somewhere that Brady does like to work. He works outside of the field about 23% of the time, but that's going to be a little bit of hindrance if the Packers can keep that side of the field kind of minimized. One thing that is important to note here is that the Packers allow 95 QBR to the deep right side of the field. And when I say deep, I mean more than 15 yards down the field on the right-hand side. They allow 95 QBR. So if I'm the Packers, if I'm LaFleur, I am really trying to prepare as best I can for what I'm thinking the Buccaneers will do, or for what I know Tom Brady wants to do. I know he wants to go short left, he wants to go deep right, and they probably want to run the ball and kind of test out my defense. So you're going to have to formulate a defense that can be prepared for those kind of things. And if I know it, I'm sure he knows it, and people around his coaching staff know that. So I would expect them to make some sort of defensive adjustments. If nothing else, I'm thinking they're probably going to make a concerted effort to stop the run. Really, that's going to come in down to play in the second half of the game, when the defense is tired, when everybody's cold, when they're ready to go home, you know, who wants to stop the run, who's going to step up and hit Fournette and get Ronald Jones behind the line. They're going to need to work on that to make sure that they can limit the Buccaneers as much as possible. As far as the Packers offense is concerned, Rodgers was passing, again, short right, short left. Both of them, he gets a 120 QBR. And he also goes deep down the field to the right side a lot on first and third down. Comes up to 12% of the time. And he has a 123 QBR, which is huge. Just for sake of comparison, Brady has a 127 QBR. Rodgers, though, he likes to do it on first and third down. So third down is a little more predictable. Third down is usually, you know, hey, we need a big play here. We need to go get a first down. It's third and eight, whatever the case is. So we kind of see that one coming. But again, if he can do that more on first downs, take advantage of that, I could see them having some big plays. And just if they can jump out to a lead, race out to a lead as early as possible, on the quickest path to victory, as Warren Sharp says, that's going to be to their advantage and kind of make the Bucs play to their hand. The Buccaneers, as far as their defense is concerned, only allow about an 84 QBR short right, and that is where Rodgers likes to work most, but they allow a 104 QBR short left. Could see Aaron Rodgers kind of shifting that direction, knowing that the defense is going to give him a little bit more there. They also allow a 98 QBR deep right down the field. That's, again, important to know, because that could be a deciding factor here, is who gets the most deep shots down the field. And if you didn't know this, the team that has more explosive plays in the game, meaning plays that are 20 yards or more, typically wins the game. So who can take advantage of that deep right-hand side? Watch those plays. Be prepared to see some shots taken down that side of the field. I wouldn't be surprised if they kind of shade Devontae Adams over that way, or with Buccaneers if they try to put maybe like Antonio Brown, if he's healthy, kind of on the right-hand side and kind of go down for some deep routes. Let's go into some other advantages or disadvantages here. So as far as the rest is concerned, the Packers have a little bit more than a day worth of a rest advantage here, and that's because they played Saturday morning. So they played early Saturday, finished her game, I want to say it was about 3:30 my time, which is central time. Went back home and rested, watched the rest of the games. The Buccaneers played Sunday night, and they played away, so they played in New Orleans. Then they had to travel back to Tampa Bay, and depending on what time they did that and how they got situated, they might not have been really ready to practice until Tuesday. Maybe had like a walkthrough Monday night, just depending on what happened. So I haven't heard a lot about that yet. I would expect to see some more as far as their practice routine comes out as we go through. But as far as rest, I know it sounds ridiculous because it's just one day, you know, big deal, right? In this case, it can be, especially because the Packers already had the bye week previously, so they were already better rested. But now the extra 24 hours of not only not having to play, but also the time and the kind of the travel issue is also big. Speaking of travel, that's the next point. So the Buccaneers, this is their third road game in a row. And so I'm sure you know that, you know, they came into the playoffs at the fifth seed, so they've had to travel every time, and this league won't be any different. But if we go back to the regular season, their last regular season game was against the Falcons, and it was there in Tampa Bay. Prior to that, though, they did have two road games. So this week will be the fifth road game they've had out of 6 weeks. So 5 out of 6 weeks, they are going to be on the road. Again, you might think this is ridiculous. You might think, oh, well, it's fine. They're just, you know, they're getting first class treatment all the way, private jets or whatever the case is. That may be true, but I will tell you this. Think about the last time you took a vacation. You know, even if it was a 30-minute drive somewhere, it tires you out. You know, the packing, getting ready, going, especially this is a work trip for them. So they're not going there to just hang out. They're going there with all their, you know, luggage and stuff and getting ready and telling their kids bye and whatever else. Going there, most likely for at least a day, if not more, and getting packed back up, getting all their stuff, moving and coming back, and then trying to almost immediately go back to practice. So they've been doing that for 5 out of 6 weeks. So I wouldn't be surprised if that catches up to them. If you see them come out the first quarter, at least a little slow, a little sluggish. Obviously, it's the playoffs, so they should be as hyped as possible. But that does not mean that these guys are robots. It comes into play, especially when they're traveling somewhere they don't want to be. You don't want to be in, you know, freezing conditions. So as far as the weather is concerned for the game, and I mentioned it earlier, it's going to be freezing. So it's going to be roughly 30 or below, depending on, you know, how the weather maybe fluctuates between now and then. But it's going to be 30 at the highest. They are expecting snow and winds from 5 to 10 miles per hour. So as far as the over-under is concerned, the cold doesn't have as big of a deterrent. It's not as big of a deterrent as some people may think. It's more the wind. 5 to 10 miles per hour, though, is not huge. So usually 12 miles per hour and up is when we start seeing the passing game get affected. So if the weather stays as planned for right now, we should be able to hit the over on this one. It's at 51 right now, which is a key number for totals, but I could see us really going over that. Trends, the last time these teams played, the Bucks won 38-10, which is important because the last times, there's been 6 times this has happened, where a team gets blown out by 20 points or more, and then meets again in the playoffs. And in those 6 times, the team that got blown out, in this case being the Packers, comes up 2-4 straight up and against the spread. So they kind of have that trend line working against them. That's about 33% of the time they win. So not looking good there if you want to take that trend into consideration. My prediction for this game would be that it ends up being like a 31-28 kind of game. But again, there is differential there. So there's roughly about a touchdown variance for each team. So if this gets up to like a 38-31 kind of game, something like that, wouldn't totally surprise me either. If I had to put this down somewhere, on a chart or anything like that, I'm kind of going to put myself in the middle and say it's about a 35-31 final score, which does cover for the Packers, and is 2 numbers that we see hit relatively commonly in the NFL. As far as strength of schedule, which is another point I like to look at, the Buccaneers actually have the advantage here. So their offensive strength of schedule was the 24th easiest. I mean, it's about the 9th hardest. And the Rams' strength of schedule, as far as offensively is concerned, was the 14th easiest. So Buccaneers did have the harder path to get here. The defensive strength of schedule, Buccaneers had the 26th easiest, which is about the 7th hardest. And the Packers had the 19th easiest. So a little bit closer there, but Buccaneers still have the harder path to get here, meaning that they are the more tested team, if you want to take that into consideration. As far as point averages are concerned, Buccaneers, just strictly working off average, should score about 24 points. Packers score 30. Again, that's, if you've heard me before, this is not indicative. I'm not saying this is what's going to be. I use these scores more as of a indicator to where I think the coach is going to really emphasize his scoring. Some coaches like to come out with scripted plays and scripted sets that they think are going to get them a touchdown right off the bat. Sean McVay's great at that. If you've watched the Rams game, almost every time, the Rams are excellent at scoring on their first drive. He scripts up wonderful games, like first game drives, that is. They almost always end in some sort of points being put on the board, and when that doesn't happen, when they don't score, it's usually because something happened. There was either a flag or a fumble or something unpredicted that happened. So with these two teams, neither of them really, I have not seen that from either of these teams. Both of them kind of come out, put field goals up, kind of, for a boxing analogy, it's like a boxers coming out, just kind of jabbing each other for the first round or two. They're just kind of filling it out and seeing where they're going to get the best kind of bang for their buck. So first quarter may be a little bit slower. Both of these teams, though, excel at scoring in the second quarter, meaning they've made adjustments. They have found out where the defense maybe has a weak spot or is going to give them a little bit more, and they both score really heavily in the second quarter. So I know a lot of people out there like playing the quarterly plays. I would take the second quarter over. I believe as of right now they have the second quarter at 10 points. The Bucks usually score about 11 points in the second quarter, which is, again, obviously an average. Packers only allow 7. Packers have been scoring 16 points in the second quarter. The Bucks allow 10. So I could see that second quarter, just the second quarter alone, being about 20 to 21 points, kind of depending on what happens there. So keep that in mind as you look at the over-unders for not just the second quarter, but the first half. And as far as possible plays in this game, so I have Packers -3, which is that's kind of the prevailing number out there right now. I have the first half over 24 points, and then the second quarter over. For me, I would personally take it all the way up to 14, but I do know that there are some lower numbers in that. Like I said, I believe I've seen a 10 and an 11 out there. So shop around for the numbers, but those are the plays I'd be looking at. My best bet for this week is the Packers -3. Last thing I want to hit on here is just some historical numbers as far as this particular round is concerned. And give me just a moment. So for the conference round in the NFL playoffs, conference has, over the last 5 years, averaged 1.6 home teams winning per year. So there's only two games, obviously, in this round every year. So most years, both of the home teams win. 80% of home teams have won this particular week. Pretty good trend line for the Chiefs and the Packers. So back in 2018, both the home teams lost. Other than that, the other 4 years saw all of the home teams win. So really good trend line there if you like the Packers or if you like the Chiefs. As far as number of one-score games, only 40% of the games have ended up being one-score games, or that breaks down to roughly one game. Of these two, I'm more inclined to say that this game, the Packers and Buccaneers, could turn out to be a one-score game, mainly because the Bills and the Chiefs should, assuming Mahomes is healthy, should put up a lot of points. And anytime you get over, 55, 58 points, kind of the value of one touchdown or one field goal, it gets diminished just by the sheer fact that there's more points on the board. So that game or that final score could end up looking like a blowout, like a 10, 11, 14 point differential, where it's really seems close until maybe the fourth quarter or something happens. But this game, Packers-Buccaneers, I could see this one being the closer one. I do believe the Packers will cover, but I think it's going to be the Packers by like 4-7 somewhere. So kind of take that with a grain of salt, if you like, but that's where the trends stand. So, again, coaching grade, home team win percentage, one score win percentage, how many times do we have one score games in this particular round of the playoffs, it all points to the Packers. So everything I have points to the Packers. Yes, there are some elements in there that the Buccaneers are going to win at, certain aspects of the game that they could really take advantage of. But in my opinion, kind of like I said with the Ravens last week, the Buccaneers need to come in not only with a perfect game plan, but they need to execute it perfectly, meaning that Mike Evans can't get beat by J.R. Alexander. Chris Godwin has to show up big. Not worried about Tom Brady, obviously. The guy's going to be awesome, so he's going to do what he does. But the rest of the team around him needs to play perfectly, and the Buccaneers' defense needs to come up big. Buccaneers' defense needs to have a plan, or some sort of game plan at least, on how they're going to stop Rodgers. How are they going to limit what Davante Adams does, as well as how can they stop Rodgers from extending the play, kind of just keeping the chains moving, and really being aware of the deep threats. Because you can stop the little short stuff and Aaron Rodgers will take you over the top. And if you start having to adjust for over the top, that's going to open up a can of worms with Aaron Jones just dicing you up all over the field. So, like I said, the Buccaneers can win. I do think it's going to be a close game. But with all of that being considered and everything that I've showed, all of my stats, all of my kind of handicapping skills here and numbers, are leading me to the Packers minus 3. I also like I said, first half over, second quarter over. So take those into consideration as well, depending on what numbers you can get. I will have another video later this week talking about the Chiefs and the Bills, obviously. And it's really going to depend on Mahomes and his health. I do believe he's going to play. And if you like the Chiefs right now, I would tell you to probably go get the number you can at this point, the minus 3. Because as soon as he gets cleared, that number is going to go up. It's going to end up at minus 4, if not higher. Good luck to everybody out there. Hopefully this was informative. If you do have any questions, concerns, anything you'd like to add here that maybe I missed or that I'm not critiquing as harshly as I should, please feel free to leave it in the comments below. Like, comment, subscribe below. Appreciate it. Appreciate all the views. Thank you, and have a great day.